who's in favor, yes, Common Core. Okay, and those no, Common Core, the rest? Interesting.
The different methods that they teach you with, like in our class today, we learned two different methods to do the same kind of problem. And it kind of felt kind of rushed, because we got to fit everything in before the Common Core Regents and the regular Regents and the state tests. And we got to fit all that in. But then, you know, some kids like to learn different methods and they adapt better to different, the one that they like suits them. But then some don't learn it at all because they're too confused by learning all these different types, but so fast that they can't understand it.
Whether we have, if we like Common Core, we think it's going to be good for the future, we do need to slow it down. And maybe have someone in a younger grade, say, learn it through the grades.
Making reasonable decisions to help students succeed. Welcome to Your Voice. I'm Julia Locandy. Today we're joined by Senator Phil Boyle. Senator, how are you today?
Good, Julia.
So Common Core, it has been in negotiations that's made its way into the budget.
Yes, yes. It's been a huge issue, as you know, Julia, for a couple of years now. And started out actually with business leaders a number of years ago on a national level to come up with a curriculum that would elevate our students and what they were learning to prepare them for an international global competition. Problem is that I think that the way it's been implemented here in New York State and other states has been problematic. It's been rushed, and as that young man said in the video, they're doing so much so quickly that a lot of kids are not learning anything at all. I'd like to see, and a lot of my colleagues have talked about slowing down implementation, and as you said, it's now in our budget, which I believe will be passed today, to say we'll put a two-year hold on it, on testing for students. The test will be given. We can't stop them from being given. However, the grades will not count towards advancement regarding each grade level.
All right, so you heard a lot from parents and teachers, but when you're putting your thoughts together, you thought, I really want to hear what the students have to say. So trying to take the next step, you reached out to the kids.
Yeah, we had done that, and we'd heard from a lot of parents, a lot of teachers, a lot of mental health professionals who said that the kids were under a great deal of stress, but we had not heard from the students. And I think this was a unique thing. I think ours was the first office in the state to do this. We actually had a forum for students that have been undergoing Common Core testing and teachings. And we got a wide variety. I was actually interested because so much of it is very extremely negative on every level from the parent and teacher perspective. The students were split about 50-50. Mm-hmm. Some kids liked the challenge, some kids did not. But universally, every single one of them said it was implemented poorly. It put a lot of pressure on the teachers. The teachers were not doing as good a job conveying it. The students were not doing a good job as learning it. So they agree. Some of them agree that Common Core is good, but it needs to go further down in the future.
All right. Let's show our viewers part of that focus group.
I've been hearing from parents and teachers that there's a sense, a different vibe, if you will, in the classroom. And how do you think that you look at it from your perspective as a student?
All the students can sense a higher stress level in all the teachers. Especially because they're always worried about, are we going to be prepared for the test? And the kids aren't really sure why, because we haven't really been presented with the standards or practice. So we're not really sure what's going on, but the teachers are all under a certain stress level that we can all see, and they don't really have the time to explain to us why they're stressed, just because they have so much stuff to do.
Teachers that contact my office say that that's exactly it, that they're feeling a lot of stress. It's a new curriculum. They don't really know. They're learning it themselves almost as they're teaching it. But it certainly adds to anybody's stress level.
I feel like it kind of evens out because it takes the really good teachers, mm-hmm. makes them kind of medium, and then it brings the teachers that really don't know what they're doing, and it rises them up.
Was it the teacher saying, okay, we got a whole new ball game here, or they just start giving you tests and teaching classes that were different than what you experienced before?
They're not really sure of the curriculum as much. They're kind of teaching a little bit differently, following more of what the state has provided for them instead of their own ways of teaching. But like my math teacher, for example, he's actually taken the stuff that New York State has given him and kind of put it in his own terms and taught us that way. And I think it's a little bit easier when they teach you in an easier way than New York State has designed the curriculum to be.
I have one more year left of high school, so
yeah.
I don't know if that's really going to help a lot when I get into college.
Right.
I don't want to be struggling in college. I want to be able to finish and get out and go on with my career.
Yep.
So the Common Core should have been put into effect a long time ago when I was still developing.
Yeah. You see it helping you as you go into college. When you're talking about some of the critical thinking you're talking about.
I mean, I don't really know all of the college curriculum, obviously, because I'm not in college, right. So I can't fully answer that, but I'm sure it'll help me, but I'm not really sure if the past learning would really have hurt anyone.
We've been thrown this tidal wave of new material, and we're struggling to adapt while we have to focus on college applications, worrying about our grades being where they should be with this new material, and everything piling up. I feel like it's going to hurt our chances of getting in, rather than letting us worry about how it's going to help us do well.
As a result of the Common Core, the test that you've had so far, were you getting A's and now you're getting C's, or vice versa?
For the state exams, mine went down from a 4 to a 3.
I study a lot, but I feel like we are not, we're not like ready yet. Like the teachers, they didn't set us up for that procedure. They just basically just threw it at us. Mm-hmm. And that's what's difficult, because like you have to slowly and gradually build it up to where you're progressing, where you can take responsibility and study on your own.
It was a change, but it was a change for the better. And it didn't make my, for example, English or math, it didn't really make my grade go any lower or any higher, you know.
However you feel about it, is there something you would change about the system that of teaching it or how it's presented to you?
I can't deny that the Common Core is helpful in some ways, right? Mathematics classes, English classes, we're learning where the formulas come from, the derivations. We're learning how to read more closely, which of course helps in the future. But I'm walking into gym class and I'm being presented with a 4-page article and writing an essay summary and then a personal reaction. I really don't think that's helping the students. We go into physical education to learn about well-being and to also get some activity.
I can't tell you how great this was for me. I really, truly appreciate it. And while you're studying and going through your things in the coming weeks and a couple months, I would urge you, and I tell urge all students, to try and stay informed about what's going on outside school and maybe read the paper, whatever paper that may, or look at the internet, you guys get different news. But do look at the debate that's going on about Common Core in Albany. It's going to be a very, very, very big debate in the next few weeks. The information you gave me and that what you're telling me today is going to be part of that debate. Because I promise you, when I go up there, I'm going to tell my colleagues exactly what you said, the pros and the cons, as we look to see what's going to happen.
So there was a decent mix of where the students stood on that, and they all seemed very mature and reasonable.
They were amazing students. They really were. And it struck me what that young man said about a tidal wave of new information. And this is a kid who's in high school, obviously. And it's like some people described it as almost learning a new language when you're in middle school or high school. It's like getting moved to a foreign country and having to learn a whole new system. Well, some of the math is that way, and some of the English and literature is that way. It was very difficult for them, and that's why I really think we need to just slow it down and ease into this. The information may be good. There's a lot of debate about the curriculum itself and the questions that are asked, but the bottom line is we need to slow down the implementation.
Yeah, even the students who said that they liked learning that way and they felt like it was helping them said that they needed a little more time.
That's right. It's happening too fast.
Yeah. Same. So you co-sponsor a bill that would essentially create a commission to review education standards.
Yeah.
What would the commission do?
Yeah, I'm a co-sponsor of a bill by Senator Zeldin, and in the Assembly, Assemblyman Graff is the sponsor. This would slow it down, create a 3-year moratorium, and create a group, a focus group, and a task force to look at this and the whole implementation of it. We need to look at the whole thing again and if the curriculum is actually going to be helpful. Now, this curriculum itself was created by people on a national level, and some may have their own reasons for doing what they're put in there, but we want New Yorkers to look at New York education. New York, it's not like we're Alabama or Mississippi or some state low on the educational charts. New York state schools have always been at or near the top of the education system in the country, and we don't want to throw the baby out with the bathwater when we look at Common Core implementation here in New York.
Okay, the next time you come in, we can talk about it as it relates to the budget.
Great.
Okay, so new news about the miracle drug you told us about last time you were here that reverses the effects of opiate addiction, or overdose.
Overdose, yes.
The Senate passed legislation to help. Let's take a look.
By making Naloxone, Narcan products more readily accessible to New York State citizens, we are going to save lives. Last year, in Suffolk County, 563 people received treatment from Naloxone during heroin epidemics. This is just in Nassau County. There's no question it's going to save lives on a statewide basis.
So what would this legislation do?
This will make naloxone or Narcan product more readily accessible around the state. Right now, it's limited to certain healthcare providers. This would make it available on a statewide pilot project, if you will, to first responders and make it available to parents and people, relatives and friends of heroin addicts and opiate addicts, so they can have the Narcan with them, just, God forbid, there's a situation where they need it. Their friend is overdosing.
Right, so you have set aside a day to educate people about this in your district, April 22nd.
That's right. At the Deer Park Fire Department, we're going to have a training course for anybody who's a family member, a friend, or even a drug addict themselves who thinks that they may be in need of using this to help an overdose victim. And as I said in the last show, it is a miracle drug. I've seen it work where it saves people lives without a doubt. And I don't know the numbers now, but it changes on a daily basis because every day in New York State, people's lives are being saved with Narcan, stopping them from overdosing on heroin.
Right. And as the chairman of a new task force on heroin, you are providing forums of discussion around the state.
Yes. We're going to have forums statewide, Buffalo, New York City, Long Island. Our first one is on April 8th out on Long Island. And we're going to have experts in treatment and prevention of heroin addiction, and also law enforcement officials, to find out the best way to combat this statewide problem. And we're going to talk to prosecutors and treatment providers across the state. I think at last count, we're at 9 or 10 forums around the state. We're going to have a report ready on June 1st and to say, okay, this is the type of legislation we need. We need to fund these type of programs for prevention and treatment, and we may need to increase criminal penalties on drug dealers. So as an overall plan to stop the heroin epidemic.
Great. So more information on your website, boyle.nysenate.gov.
Exactly.
I noticed a unique thing that you do on your website. You post job listings. Do people reach out to you a lot and ask about jobs?
Oh, yes. I mean, the economy is still struggling in large parts, and especially on Long Island. And we've had a job fair where we had several hundred people come and many companies come. And we also do that on a weekly basis. We put job listings on. People contact us. We put them in touch with the employer. And then any recommendation of a constituent I can make, I usually meet with them and put a good word into the employer. We've had some success.
Great. So to check out some companies hiring, boyle.nysenate.gov. There's one event you put on every year, and it's to celebrate Black History Month. On your website, you shared who you honored this year. So let's take a look at a video that someone from your office put together.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and for you.
I'm really honored, and I can't really put it into words, but I'm really honored.
We're here at the Bayshore Brightwaters Public Library for our second annual Black History Month celebration. We have a lot of exciting things planned for the evening and a great list of honorees.
The most important thing is to reach out to the community, always give back, and never give up. The small things that we do in the community are small victories.
You have Martin Luther King, you have Sojourner Truth, you have various leaders that have come before me, including those who are not formally recognized, such as parents in the community, grandparents in the community. All those individuals have helped to pave at least my way and my success.
When I was coming up, I knew and seen Martin Luther King when I was a little girl and Shirley Chisholm. I always wanted to be a fighter, and I am a fighter, but I'm a good fighter.
They definitely open doors, open windows, open heavens for us on our behalf. And it's on their shoulders that we stand tonight to celebrate the opportunity to make a difference in the lives of others.
Thank you for what you do on a daily basis in our community, your leadership and your courage. And whether you're retired, whether you're in the middle of your career, whether you're just starting out your career, thank you for what you do every day for our communities.
Young people are very important because when we leave here as adults, somebody's going to take our place. And if we don't train them properly, give them the encouragement, the uplifting, all these different things, education in particular, if we don't give them that, then America will crumble. So we've got to help the young people. We've got to help them.
We thank you for showing us the example and taking away our excuses so that we might run the race that is set before each one of us. So as we celebrate these honorees tonight, I think you have already been challenged to go back to your communities, go back to your streets, go back to your schools, go back to your place of businesses, and inspire someone to run their race with patience and with diligence.
What a wonderful world!
So there's a lot of positivity, a lot of depth from what they were saying, actually.
Oh, absolutely. It's a wonderful celebration, and it's a great night for faith and education and singing and dancing, too. I look forward to it each year, definitely.
Yeah, so on your website, you can learn more about that and everyone who was honored.
Great.
Thank you for being with us, Senator.
Thanks, Julia.
Thank you for watching Your Voice with Senator Phil Boyle. For additional information, boyle.nysenate.gov.